Hey everyone, Drew Murray here with D20 Advice, and this is a new video. So, despite my intended hiatus due to university concerns, I find myself coming out of hiding for two reasons. First reason being I wanted to try out my new microphone setup. I've made like a makeshift mini sound booth type thing. But the main point of the video, so point number two, is that Nerdarchy just released a new video talking about Monster BFFs. This is a franchise that they've had going on for a little while now, and it's been fairly entertaining. However, they hit upon a concept that my wife and I, my wife mostly, to be fair, I pioneered this, the second part, but the part that Nerdarchy were talking about, my wife sort of came up with. And it's an idea that will have been done for decades, but it's one that we haven't encountered in the popular sphere yet. It's not something that we've seen talked about too much. And that is the concept of putting monsters inside of monsters, or combining monsters in unique ways. This is the core concept of Monster BFFs that Nerdarchy have done. But my wife's first foray into GMing for a group, she had suits of animated armor in D&D 5th edition. And this is about 2 or 3 years ago. So she had suits of animated armor with mephits inside. And I can't remember if there were a combination of like dust and air mephits, or just air mephits, or something like that. But there were impish creatures messing about within the mechanisms of the armor. So once the suits of armor were destroyed, the bits and pieces of the armor would still wander around and mess about with the party. And they need to work out that actually, no, there are these invisible or barely visible impish creatures messing about with the armor pieces. And it worked fantastically well. This was also in combination with using animated swords with the animated armor. So the animated armor would come along, they'd wield swords. As the armor was getting knocked down, or as it became advantageous for them to do so, they would loose their swords and the animated sword would fly around and start attacking people, while the suits of armor chased down other people and bashed them with fists. And then once that was all done and dealt with, the mephits would then leap out. This being my wife's first campaign, she made sure that each combat encounter was perfectly balanced, and so the mephits didn't use any of their abilities or their hit points and armor class or anything, didn't really come into play until everything else had been dealt with. So it was handled as two concurrent combat encounters, not one combat encounter with all the challenge ratings mixed in and everything, which is subtly different from Nerdarchy's thing. But because Nerdarchy produced this video, I felt that I needed to leap in and say my piece about the idea that I had first, because there's something nice about being the first, or among the first, to get your idea out there. And again, it's likely not a unique idea, but again, not one I've seen out there. It's not published anywhere that I know of. And that is creatures becoming other creatures. Now, the idea of a creature's life cycle being different to that offered in the Monster Manual is something that I've seen about the place. Things like goblins becoming hobgoblins or bugbears later on in life, that they are just youthful versions of the older creatures. That's something I've come across. But this isn't what I'm talking about. Later on in the same keep that we had this animated armor mephit fiasco, there was also a banquet room with skeletons. And so you had standard humanoid skeletons, along with one minotaur skeleton. And players bashed them about, knocked their bones everywhere, defeated these creatures, and then moved out of that room to go to a side room, and then on their way back through, the bones started moving again, and they coalesced into one gigantic bone naga. So this is creatures coming out of other creatures, sort of. It's essentially just kind of like in computer games, you get the kind of evolution of an enemy at some point, like especially with like bosses and things, you'd defeat them and then another form would emerge before you get a chance to properly rest and change up. It's that sort of thing. But trying to be imaginative with it, see what you can do with it, what makes sense, what's consistent within your game world. And it made sense that a whole bunch of ribs and arms and things would come to make up this kind of snake-like body with a minotaur's head kind of forming this kind of snake-like head thing with like a jaw made up of a couple of like shoulder blades as well. So it was an interesting experiment that we did, and it was fun, it worked. You know, the players really enjoyed it. So I wanted to leap in with another D20 advice video saying, think more broadly about your combat encounters. Think more broadly about your just encounters in general. Think more broadly about your world. What could possibly lead on logically in your world? If you want to have suits of armor with, as the Nerdarchy video suggested, with rocket punch things, with something being able to like launch the gauntlets off and punch someone in the face, you know, dozens of feet away, do it. Find some way to do it, or just do it. You know, just bend the rules slightly and create a homebrew creature. And that's essentially the gist of what I'm trying to say, is that from the bones of skeletons, we created another creature. There's no reason why magic couldn't be involved and they couldn't have draped flesh over themselves, or that a zombie couldn't suddenly get empowered by a dark relic and suddenly become an equivalent of a flesh golem in powers and abilities. So you might not call it a flesh golem, it might not have the same fluff backstory as a flesh golem, but the powers, abilities, maybe the appearance even of a flesh golem. And so you just use a flesh golem entry in the monster manual. You can have the same thing with what are they called now? The wood creatures, the kind of the branch monsters that are supposed to be from the blood of a vampire tainting the soil and the woodland around them. And so you get these kind of sprite-like creatures running around as collections of twigs. Some of them are just like thorns, and some of the whole sticks and things. You could have those be a form of treant, or have them Voltron style all stacked together to become a treant. You could even describe it as looking differently. It is just a whole bunch of twigs holding onto each other. But if you wanted something the size of a treant, doing the damage of a treant, but you don't like the backstory of a treant, give it a different backstory. Whole bunch of mushrooms just all like glob together and become the equivalent of a treant. If you like the idea of a minotaur but you don't like it having a bull's head, change that. Have it be something else. What something looks like, or what the backstory is as given, isn't the be all and end all. If this is going to be somewhat difficult to get your head around if you're not already kind of in this mind space. But if it isn't a codified rule, if it isn't hit points or armor class or an actual ability or anything like that, if it's not that, if it's just the written fluff of something, if it's not the condensed down, this is the rules, you can ignore it. It means nothing to your play experience unless you want it to add to the play experience, as a novel would add to your play experience. It's just, it's extra story, it's extra stuff that you can use or discard as you so desire. Now, having said that, the same applies to the stats. I would recommend that you play a lot and that you get used to what certain stats feel like in your games with your group and how people react to them. So many people play the game in so many different ways. Some people treat it as a strategic warfare game. Some other people treat it as a tactical combat simulation. Other people treat it as a role-playing game where you are playing the role of a person and that fighting isn't the be-all and end-all of everything. Some people get hung up on mechanics, other people are more there for the story. There's so many different ways to play the game. And so it's difficult to come up with a way to describe how to handle the actual hard and fast stats without impacting on at least one of these playstyles. What I've said before about the fluff can apply to all the playstyles. You can change any of the fluff whatsoever. If anyone does get hung up on that specific fluff, and that's not like group agreement that you've had, that you would stick to the storylines within there, then I'd say you've got a problem there. You're not quite grasping the spirit of the game in that case. You may very much love the backstory and the storyline, but that's not the spirit of the thing under any playstyle. But the mechanics in certain playstyles are gospel, and in other playstyles, not so. And in quite a lot of the playstyles, people accept that you can, some people call it homebrew. I just called it playing the game. I've only recently started using modules and things in like 17, 18, 18? God, I'm getting old. 18 years of GMing games of Dungeons & Dragons and other role-playing games. It occurs that the rules are more guidelines. It says at the beginning of the books that you know the rules are simply there as a guide, and that essentially the rules that you play with in your game are the rules that you and all the other players agree to, and that the GM is there to adjudicate and referee any disputes during the game to keep the fun going. That's your job. So when it comes to monsters and coming up with fun and interesting encounters, tweaking the rules for the sake of fun, go for it. But I'd recommend experience. I'd recommend if your group is the tactical combat type, if you're there with your maps and minis and you want to work out exactly where everyone is at all times, and you care a lot about what certain mechanics do and what certain combinations of mechanics do, and thinking about what's the most powerful or least powerful choice to make, and you inform your decisions as a player and how that influences the decisions of the character on that information, then be wary about messing about with the mechanics. Your combat balance may be affected. But it is a lot of fun. And it's not as wild and crazy as just throwing the rule books out and saying, oh, just give it any hit points, any armor class. By tweaking things or creating combinations of creatures, like having a whole bunch of skeletons as one combat encounter, and then once they collapse, they rise again as a bone snake for you to fight as a separate encounter, possibly picking up some extra dark energy from the evil of the combat or feeding the god of war or whatever, and now all of a sudden it's got these spell-like abilities that a bone knocker has. Whatever explanation you want to shove in there, go for it. I've kind of lost the thread exactly of where I am, but essentially it all boils down to have fun with it, mess about with creatures, do all sorts of things. I've come up with a treant example. Suits of armor, we've done similar things, in fact. I think later on in the same keep, or perhaps in another keep, oh yes, it was in the same one. Again, they left the room, found a bone naga after the skeletons and everything, went through all the rest of the castle keep, and on their way back out through the room with all the suits of armor, all kind of like gathered together, collapsed down and fused into, I can't remember if it was an iron golem or some other kind of like suit of armor type thing, not a death knight, but something else, something with a slightly higher armor class and with a giant sword and everything. I'll picture the image in my head, and it reminds me of the iron golem drawing from the third edition book, but I'm not sure if it was, but something along those lines. And it's cool to have this idea that once you've defeated an opponent that they can return in some fashion, or once you've dealt with one facet of the game world, that another bit can rear its head. So this is all either new information and you'll find it extremely useful, or it's old hat information. And you're wondering why you're hearing this again in a, like, far too long rant from a guy. I've got no real answers to that. If you've heard this kind of stuff before, great. I would love to play in some of your games. If you've not heard this stuff before, I'd recommend trying it out. Start small. Start simple. Start with things that you can easily wrap your head around, like inanimate suits of armor or magic swords or things of that nature. On another note to do with this, also consider rewards for your players. Have a magic item create itself from the battle. One such example is I allowed weapons to become magical weapons, just getting a plus one enhancement, if they were used to kill a dragon. It was never explained to the players beforehand, but if the killing stroke of a dragon was made by a sword, that sword was now magical, dipped in the blood of a dying dragon. Some magical fluff like that can really enhance the game. It also gives the players a way to create magical items, or to try and think about how they can gain certain advantages, with it still being very, very difficult to do. So you could have them defeat a room full of animated armors, and once they get to the end of the corridor and find the evil shrine where clerics have been doing all sorts of strange and arcane, lowercase a, rituals, you defeat the clerics and you hallow the area, taking the evil shrine's power away from it as part of the atmospheric disturbance from the evil getting sucked away into another plane of existence. All the suits of armor just kind of like all rush down the corridor towards her and crash against this evil icon, crushing it to pieces, and the magical shards start enchanting bits of the armor. The one piece that seems to be completely intact is just happens to be a helmet, and so a fragment falls onto the helmet, heats it up slightly and sinks in, so you've got like a gemstone in the head of the helmet. It looks slightly crude but still not unseemly, and you've now got a steel helmet with an opaque gemstone in the head of it. It's a magical helmet. You can now have it do whatever you so desire. You could have it detect good and evil with that specific example, or it could be give you a single use of bless per long rest or something along those lines. Try and make it all match narratively so that your game doesn't feel like a series of very discrete, distinct things like you get often with computer games. I know I mentioned computer games as an example and a counter-example of this, where you get bosses transforming from one type to another, but they're still in very distinct scenes and things, so it can feel kind of clunky, but it's a good way of moving from one thing to another. But when it comes to role-playing games, try and keep it all narratively consistent. Everything that I've said in this video and in some other videos, you could boil it all down to that essential nugget. Try and keep your games narratively consistent. So magic items coming into being from actions that the players have done makes a lot of sense. It's fun to play in a game where that happens. Other fights arising from the result of a fight that you've just had, it's fun, keeps it narratively consistent. Another way to do this in perhaps a more comprehensible manner, rather than just things magically happening and bursting out of other things, is, well, one, bursting out of other things, you could have some kind of swarm or something burst out of the carcass of a felled etin or something. You know, it could have had a parasitic infection of some kind when you first encounter it. It's got some itching that it does, but then when you fight it, it fights just like a normal etin, and as soon as it's done, loads of bugs and things start crawling out, and you've got to deal with that. But even more mundane than that, you could have a bunch of orcs. You kill the orcs. Carrion Crawler's going to come down the corridor and try and eat those bodies now, isn't it? Yeah, so one thing leading to another is the way to think about this. Keep things narratively consistent. If you want a Carrion Crawler and you want a bunch of orcs, try and organise it so that they encounter the orcs first, have the Carrion Crawler come because of the orcs. It'll help cement the idea that the world is just happening around the players and the players live in that world, rather than the world doing things for the players. It being just a series of rooms and a series of encounters in one long linear progression, where you just move from one thing to the next. It really does help. Even if in your head, pacing it out that way still makes it seem to you like it is just moving from one thing to another, do it. Ask your players about it afterwards. I can near enough guarantee that they will enjoy it far more. So, that's my two cents, and I got in with it before anyone else that I've seen or read anywhere. So, yeah! Do that! This is combining a few different ideas that I have read from other places and seen in other places. The whole narrative consistency thing is a fairly common thing. I'm not saying I've come up with that myself. But, yeah, they're combining certain monsters and things and having them lead from one to another. That's something I've not seen elsewhere. And so I wanted desperately to make this video, get it up, get it out there. Just so that you guys have it. It continues on nicely from what Nerdarchy was saying. It will enhance your games, and I hope that you all do well with it. There's also a little part of me that just wanted to get there first. So, yeah. I'll see you guys later. Bye. Ooh. I got a dice tower. Look at the dice tower. Look at the dice tower.